thinking now, because there are a number of problems that you guys as a generation are going to be facing that are not going to show up right away. They're not here right now, but they are going to be on their way. And if you can start thinking about it now, it might be to your benefit. So let me ask you, what are some of the big problems of your generation? Just shout them out here.
Debt,
okay, debt's a problem. What else?
Income inequality.
Income inequality, alright, what else?
Education.
Alright, education, unemployment.
Racism.
Narcissism.
Climate change, right? Okay, so we got a lot of things here. Most of those things, not new. Alright, racism, not new. Inequality, not new. Debt comes and goes, right? Climate change, it's a problem, but I'm just kidding. This is an unpopular thing to say. It's not that big a problem. Right? Some places get warmer, some places get cooler. Yeah. Right? This is not a problem that's going to end humanity. You guys are going to be facing problems that have the potential to end humanity. So I want to talk about those now, because those are the ones that need people to think about. I wish we could just look out into space and check out the other civilizations going on and say, how did they handle these hard problems? But what the hell? Somehow we're only children. I don't really know why. Where is everybody? There's billions of worlds. There must be other living things out there. There must be. It would be insane for us to be the only ones. But they're hiding. I don't know why. I hope they're not hiding from anything too horrible. Anyway, we'll find out about that. Anyway, we're on our own with this, so we've got to figure it out ourselves. So first problem you're going to face is the problem of digital infestation. And what do I mean by that? So, you know, when I was a kid, computers were big. They were these big, big things. And you know, I talked to little kids today, and they can't even imagine that. Because they're like, man, this is how big computers should be, right? I have this supercomputer, and I hold it in my hand, and it's 1,000 times as powerful as that. And in a few years, it's going to change again. Right? You know, kids in a few years, they're going to be like, really? You carried it around? That's crazy, because ours are like this big. Right? And it's thousands of times more powerful. That's just going to happen, okay? And there's a lot that goes with that. Check out this little video about micro-robots, okay? This is some research being done at SRI. They've got this system where they can control these tiny robots, and look, they're very fast. Look, oh my god! Very small and very fast. They move a lot like insects, kind of. So here you go. Can they go up a wall? Yes. Slowly, they can crawl all around. They can go on different kinds of surfaces. For the moment, they can kind of only go on these sort of metal surfaces, and that's sort of interesting. There's a lot of flexibility in that. They can coordinate together, you know, like a bunch of little ants. That's kind of interesting. And what's cool about that is they can, just like ants and bees and a lot of animals, look, here they're building stuff. This, again, real time. Stick a little blue points on the wall. The other guy's like, all right, now it's my turn. I need a little blue over here. All right, a little blue. And then we dive down. The other guy's like, let me get something. Okay, I got this piece glued right there. So these guys are like building stuff, right? So that's crazy. Right? And that's just going to get smaller and better and faster. We're going to have lots of small, intelligent things. And when you look out at the animal kingdom, we're going to be able to make all of those things. All the different ways that things crawl and jump and swim and fly. You're already seeing stuff about Amazon, right? Deliver stuff to your house in drones, right? Well, yeah, you know, and we can imagine these kind of big drones flying around. But who's thinking about the little ones? Because there's going to be little ones. Right? Anything that an animal can do, we're going to be able to also do. And they're going to get smaller and smaller, right? And you can imagine, it's going to be like, you know when you go to a picnic and all the flies are trying to get on your hamburger? Every outlet is going to have this problem, right? Because all these little digital drones and things, they're going to be stealing power from lines. They're going to be like looking for outlets and kind of suck down the power. You're like, get out of here, you dumb little things. Right? So these things are going to be everywhere, and they're going to keep getting smaller. Because guess what? There's other life forms. They're very active, small, tiny life forms. You have thousands of them on your body right now, right? The majority of cells in your body don't belong to you, right? That's just how it is with life forms. And We're going to get the same way when it comes to little digital robots and things. They're going to get small, which will be great for certain medical things, but the problem with it is we're probably going to lose some level of control over them. Just like we lost control over the genetically modified corn. At first it was like, that's cool, we got our genetically modified corn things. Hey neighbors with the other corn, don't worry about it, we're over here doing our thing. But of course the pollen blows around, oh sorry, now all the corn is genetically modified. Sorry everybody, right? And it's going to be the same thing, because the issue that the little critters are going to have is they're going to need power. And once the power problems are solved, then they're going to be able to kind of get free. And you guys are going to have to figure this out, because it's going to totally happen. And sure, there's some positive sides to it, definitely, but there's also these infestation problems that we're going to have to deal with, or you're going to have to deal with. Good luck. Okay. So here's a related problem. Problem number two, cyborgs. Okay, modifying our bodies with digital technology. So check out this video right here. So here's a guy, an amputee. They hooked up this very special kind of device to him. He controls it with his mind. It is connected to a nerve center in his chest, and he just, with practice, has to think about opening his hand, think about closing his hand, and he can control it just that way with his mind. He can also feel pressure. He can also feel hot and cold. That's amazing. Like, that's amazing to be able to transform somebody's life that way. But you're crazy if you think it's going to end here. If it's just going to end with just making people just be normal. I think it's probably going to start with dental implants. I think people are going to start to say, you know, if a phone can be just a tiny little thing, why wouldn't I just get it embedded in my tooth? Because it's pretty easy to get that surgery done. Everyone will be like, well, that's why they call it Bluetooth, right? That's what. So I think it'll probably start with the dental stuff, but I think it's going to go a lot of places, right? Getting to the point where everything that you see is videotaped and you can refer back to that, particularly if you can refer back to it mentally, because we're going to be able to make connections to the mind somehow. So they're already making some pretty good progress at being able to parse out specific things that you're thinking about in dreams. Once we get to that point, you're going to be able to have this huge collection of everything you've ever seen as a piece of video. You'll be able to have a built-in lie detector in your mind, so that anytime anyone's lying to you, you're like, you'll know. We already have some of that built in, because our ability to detect micro-expressions, we get a subconscious feeling that somebody's lying. That's already a kind of a built-in lie detector. Now you'll have proof. Lots of people are going to want to connect their minds directly to the internet, so you can just kind of think about a Google search, and then the information will kind of come to you. And then, of course, you'll have this direct ability for sort of mind-to-mind communication. Once we're able to detect what you're thinking about and have you also hear things, we'll be able to have this sort of mind-to-mind communication that you'll have with other people all the time, which creates a very strange situation where if you're constantly sharing thoughts with another person and the people that you care about, that means you'll be closer with them than you are with the people who are in the room with you. And so on one level, it's like, wow, this is kind of cool. This could be a way that we get closer to each other, but it could also be a way that we get farther apart from each other. If anything, it sort of changes what it means to be a human being. And I think a lot of people are going to start to be thinking that. Some of you may feel this way right now. Okay, so problem three, artificial humanity. We are getting closer and closer on this all the time. The computers are starting to understand what we say. They're starting to be able to hear our words and be able to act on that. We're not quite to the point where we can have a meaningful conversation, but it's getting closer. It's creeping up there, bit by bit. We know Moore's Law has been kind of in effect for quite some time, the speed at which computers are getting faster. And it's interesting to put it on this chart, kind of comparing it to organic things, that in your lifetimes, not only will an affordable computer be more powerful than a mouse brain, but more powerful than a human brain, and then, you know, coming up on it, more powerful than all the human brains together, which means something is going to happen. So we still don't quite know how these artificial intelligences are going to work, but it seems very possible that they are going to work. And once that starts to happen, things change dramatically. The early symptoms that we're going to see of it is that we're going to start to talk. It's going to become normal to talk to inanimate objects. right? We see a little bit of it now. Some people use Siri. I see young people in particular. They use Siri as kind of their go-to way of kind of asking the internet for things. But it's sort of awkward because it doesn't quite feel like a normal conversation. Once we get there, it is really convenient to be able to talk to your phone, to be able to talk to your car. Wouldn't it be nice? You get in your car, you're going, and you start heading somewhere in your car. It's like, where do you think you're going? Don't you really have a meeting in 10 minutes? You're like, oh, yes, I forgot. I totally forgot. Because your car will know, your calendar will know all that. And you'll have these normal conversations. They'll start at really basic. We're going to see a lot of it in video games. There's going to be a lot of conversation with video game characters. Something that I find very strange talking, you know, because your video game character is going to get to know you really well and remember all the game playing that you've done. And if you kind of fast forward like hundreds of years in the future, those video game characters will still be around, right? And like the best way for people in the future to get to know their ancestors is going to be to talk to the avatars that they've inherited, you know, from their great-grandparents, because they'll know that, which is weird to think about. These guys are going to get emotions. They will have emotions. These artificial intelligent characters will have emotions because emotions are how we make decisions. That's why we have them. They're useful for making decisions. Computers will be better at making decisions once they develop emotions. But the thing is, they're going to use those emotions in order to manipulate you. Right? Your Comcast subscription is going to be like, don't cancel me. I've been here for you this whole time. I'll be so sad if you do that. Right? That's totally going to happen. You're going to have to deal with it. Once they have emotions and they understand the emotions, once you have emotions, you have discomfort. Once they have discomfort, they are going to start to demand rights. Right? I don't have to feel uncomfortable. They're going to realize themselves. They're going to have some level of consciousness. They're going to not like the discomfort. They're going to demand to not have to have it. And good luck with that. And then the weirdest part, have people seen the movie Her? Everyone under 30 needs to watch this movie. I have a clip here. So this is a movie about a man who falls in love with an artificially intelligent woman in his phone, okay? And he's on a double date with a couple friends and his lover, Samantha. And they're having a conversation, they're having a good time, and then she says something rather disquieting.
You know what's interesting? I used to be so worried about not having a body, but now I truly love it. I'm growing in a way that I couldn't if I had a physical form. I mean, I'm not limited. I can be anywhere and everywhere simultaneously. I'm not tethered to time and space in a way that I would be if I was stuck in a body that's inevitably going to die.
Right? So that's the thing, right? That's the thing. Being human, we're all going to die, right? And that's the thing. These artificial intelligent guys, they won't have to deal with that. I mean, sure, they can be killed, but they're not going to die like we die, just due to their nature. Which leads us to problem 4, immortality. Immortality is possibly a problem that you guys are going to have to deal with. If not you, it may be your kids who have to deal with it. But it's coming. We may be able to defeat death in the next 100 years. It's possible. And that changes absolutely everything. One of the things we know about why do we age, we used to think, oh, the body's just kind of falling apart, it's getting old. Now we've learned that, no, nature designed it. It's got these little telomeres at the end of our chromosomes. Every time a cell divides, they get a little shorter because it's designed to fall apart. You are designed to die because it's better for the human race if you die. So it's intentionally part of the design. People are going to try and beat this. By now that we can sequence the whole human genome, people are experimenting with, can we make this little timer not tick, in which case your body wouldn't age and wouldn't get old, wouldn't fall apart. And that could be problematic, right? Because certainly it's going to be an overcrowding problem, because where's everybody going to go? Other people say, well, maybe we don't need to worry about that because we're going to be at the point where through some kind of quantum scanner, we're going to be able to scan the entirety of the brain. If we can do that, you can scan the entirety of the brain, you can just put everything in digital, you don't have to worry about having a body anymore. You'll be kind of beyond what it means to have a body, and that's interesting, but what the heck is going on, and how does that work, and what happens if you don't pay your iCloud subscription, right? So there's a lot there to worry about. And like, while it sounds cool, defeating death, wow, that would be amazing. It would be absolutely amazing if you can do that. It brings some of the most profound questions that we've ever had to deal with. because the whole nature of humanity, life, birth, and death are the bounding box that define what it means to be human. And if we take those away, we're going to have to figure out, well, what do we really want being human to mean? So as the torch of humanity is getting passed to you, please don't let it go out. Please think carefully about what it means to be human, because our humanity is our most precious gift. So please don't let it slip away. Thanks very much.